Hello students, welcome to the lecture on digital career modulation techniques. Now this we will call it as passband data transmission. It is different from the baseband data transmission which has been considered. Now baseband data transmission means that when you convert a sequence of zeros and ones into a signal which is to be transmitted by using the line codes, that is for example unipolar, RZ, NRZ, bipolar and so on, then you transmitted the signal as it is, the line code which is of the in the electrical form as it is without any change, that is known as baseband transmission. This is passband transmission. In this transmission the signal is used as a modulating signal to modulate a high frequency carrier and then it is transmitted. So generally for wireless channels passband data transmission is preferred. So in baseband pulse transmission, a data stream represented in the form of a discrete pulse amplitude PAM signal is transmitted directly over a low pass channel. In digital passband transmission on the other hand, the incoming data stream modulates a high frequency carrier, usually it is sinusoidal, with fixed frequency limits imposed by a band pass channel of interest. The communication channel used for passband data transmission may be a microwave radio link, a satellite channel or the like. The modulation process making the transmission possible involves switching the amplitude, frequency or phase of a sinusoidal carrier in some fashion in accordance with the incoming data. Thus, there are three basic signaling schemes as shown in the figure. You can see the figure. Actually, the carrier, although it is a continuous time function, but the variations in its parameters are discrete, that is as per 0 and 1. That is why we call it a digital signal. As you can see in the first picture, it is amplitude shift keying. The carrier is switched off when 0 is transmitted and it is switched on when 1 is transmitted. That is why sometimes it is also known as OOK, that is on off keying. So this is amplitude is being shifted between 0 and some value maximum, right, in the discrete steps. Similarly, in the second picture, this is a binary phase shift keying where the different phase is transmitted. For 0 it is pi and for 1 it is 0. So you can clearly see at the boundary there is an abrupt phase change of 180 degree. And in the third picture, the frequency, two frequencies are being used, frequency shift keying, say for example F1 for 0 and F2 for 1. Again the shift in frequency is in discrete step, that is why we call it as frequency shift keying. Now all these schemes ASK, FSK and PSK, they may be viewed as a special case of amplitude modulation, frequency modulation and phase modulation. Now you can note the following points, that in continuous wave modulation it is usually difficult to distinguish between phase modulated and frequency modulated signal merely by looking at their waveform. That is, you require the modulating signal to distinguish between an FM and PM wave. But this is not true for PSK and FSK, as you have already seen in the picture. You can clearly distinguish between a frequency shift keying waveform and a phase shift keying waveform. Second is, unlike ASK signal, both PSK and FSK signals have a constant envelope. The second property which makes PSK FSK signal impervious to the amplitude non-linearities commonly encountered in microwave radio and satellite channels. It is for this reason that PSK and FSK signal are preferred to ASK signal for passband data transmission over non-linear channels. Now let us start with taking the case of binary phase shift keying. Now we are saying that it is BPSK, binary phase shift keying. There are other forms of phase shift keying also, like QPSK, MARPSK and so on, but here we are considering binary. So the symbols which are to be transmitted are either 0 or 1. Coherent, we are calling it coherent BPSK because during detection we are using a coherent detector which requires the carrier at the receiving end also, and this carrier should be perfectly synchronized with the carrier which has been used at the transmitter, or in other words it should be coherent with the carrier that is being used at the transmitter. Now coherence means what? That the two carriers, they should have the same frequency, and ideally the phase difference should be zero, or if it is non-zero then it should be constant, that is it should not change with time. So it is a coherent binary phase shift keying system. So two pairs of signals, two binary symbols are there, 1 and 0, and we have to transmit two signals corresponding to 1 and 0. One signal, as you can see in the picture, S1T is root 2 EB by TB cos 2 pi FCT. EB is the transmitted signal energy per bit, TB is the bit interval, and we have written it, the amplitude of the signal, as under root 2 EB by TB, which gives you the signal energy. If we find out the signal energy, then it comes out to be EB. That is why this kind of notation is being used here. S2T for 0, we are transmitting a phase of pi, that is cos of 2 pi FCT plus pi, that is equal to minus cos of 2 pi FCT. That is, when you change from 1 to 0, there is an abrupt change in phase of 180 degree. Now, to ensure that each transmitted bit contains an integral number of cycles of a carrier wave, the carrier frequency FC is chosen equal to NC by TB for some fixed integer NC. That is, the bit interval is TB, right, and it should contain integral number of cycles of a carrier, that is 1, 2, 3, 4 like this, not 2.5, 3.75 and so on. That is why to ensure this, FC should be equal to NC by TB, where NC is an integer. The average probability of symbol error, or equivalently the bit error rate for binary PSK, is given as PE is half ERFC root EB by N0. Now, ERFC is a complementary error function which is defined as 2 over root pi from u to infinity e to the power minus z square dz. That is a definition, standard definition. But here what you have to understand is that this complementary error function is a decreasing function. So when PE is half ERFC root EB by N0, N0 is the power spectral density of noise which adds on to the signal in the channel. Now as we increase the transmitted signal energy per bit EB for a specified noise spectral density N0, the average probability of error PE is correspondingly reduced. Now this derivation, that is the derivation of the average probability of symbol error, is based on the assumption that the receiver which is being used is a coherent receiver. It is also known as correlator, right. The correlator are basically, they are similar to the matched filter which are used for receiving the binary PCM signal. So now let us take a look at the generation and detection of coherent binary PSK signal. Now to generate a binary PSK signal, the input binary sequence is represented in polar form with symbols 1 and 0 represented by constant amplitude level. This signal transmission encoding is performed by polar NRZ level encoder. The resulting binary wave and a sinusoidal carrier are applied to a product modulator as shown in the figure. The desired PSK wave is obtained at the modulator output. So when you take a look at the picture, there is a binary data sequence, then polar NRZ 0 level encoder. Now polar means, for example, plus A for 1, minus A for 0, and then there is a product modulator which is given a carrier 51T which is root 2 by TB cos of 2 pi FCT. So the amplitude of the incoming binary signal, it should be under root EB, that is under root EB for 1 and minus under root EB for 0. So when you combine these two, it gives you the binary PSK signal. At the receiving end, as you can see, to detect the original binary sequence of zeros and ones, the noisy PSK signal at the channel output is applied to a correlator. Correlator is a combination of a multiplier followed by an integrator, as I already told you, it is similar to the to a matched filter, which is supplied with a locally generated coherent carrier as shown in the figure. the correlator output X1 is compared with the threshold 0 volt. If X1 is greater than 0, the receiver decides in favor of symbol 1, otherwise it is 0. As you can take a look at the receiver in the picture, you will find that we are multiplying the incoming signal with 5NT, and 5NT, the same 5NT we have used as a carrier in the transmitter also. These two are in perfect coherence with each other, and it is followed by an integrator which gives some output, and that output is, compares with a threshold. Now, threshold is 0. The reason is that we are using a polar NRZ, that is plus some value for 1 and minus some value for 0. So, in between those two values, we are deciding threshold, that is why the threshold is 0. So, the decision goes in favor of 1 if X1 is greater than 0, and it goes in favor of 0 if X1 is less than 0. Let us take a look at the coherent frequency shift keying. Again, the word coherent here also means the same as was in the phase shift keying. The binary FSK system symbol 1 and 0 are distinguished from each other by transmitting one of two sinusoidal waves that differ in frequency by a fixed amount. The typical pair of waves is described by, as you can see in the picture, SIT is root 2 EB by TB. Now, same notation we are using, cosine of 2 pi FIT between 0 to TB, that is within each symbol interval 0 to TB. See, these adjacent symbol intervals or bit intervals for binary case, they are independent of each other in this case, in binary case, in the PSK case also, and in FSK case also. So, in each and every interval, we are transmitting a signal corresponding to either 1 or 0. So, we are using one frequency for 1, another frequency for 0, and EB is the transmitted energy per bit. Now, the selection of frequency, whatever you select the frequency, the difference is very important, that is F1 minus F2. That what is the difference between the frequency which you are using for 0 and what and the frequency which you are using for 1. The difference should be such that the two signals S1T and S2T should be orthogonal to each other over the bit interval, that is from 0 to TB. Now, orthogonality is important in case of all these DMTs, that is ASK, FSK, QPSK, whatever digital modulation technique you use, and whenever you are using a correlator, orthogonality is a very important feature. So, even if you are talking of transmitting M symbols, right, by using M signals, say S1T, S2T, SMT, we have to ensure that all these M signals are orthogonal to each other. So, orthogonality is important. Therefore, the difference between the two frequencies is fixed, not actually fixed, but it follows some rule. So, the transmitted frequency Fi is equal to Nc plus I divided by Tb. As you can see, again Nc is an integer, and this expression is again to ensure that a bit interval contains integral number of cycles of a carrier. So, I is equal to 1, 2, so two frequencies are there. Thus, symbol 1 is represented by S1T, 0 is represented by S2T. The FSK signal is described here is known as Sund's FSK. It is a continuous phase signal in the sense that phase continuity is always maintained, including the inter-bit switching time. This form of digital modulation is an example of continuous phase frequency shift keying, that is CPFSK. Phase is not broken. As you compare it with PSK, there is a break in the phase. Here, though the frequency changes, but phase is continuous. Such kind of scheme is known as CPFSK or Sund's FSK, which maintain the phase continuity while switching from 1 to 0 or from 0 to 1. And of course, as I have already told you, signal S1T and S2T, they should be orthogonal to each other. Now, the average probability of bit error or bit error rate for coherent FSK, as we have studied the case, is given by PE is half ERFC root EB by 2N0. Now, again it is the complementary error function is there, it is a decreasing function. As you increase EB by N0, the probability of error decreases. Now, in coherent binary FSK system, the bit energy to noise density ratio EB by N0 has to be double to maintain the same bit error rate as incoherent binary PSK system. As you can easily see that here EB by 2 N naught, there the ratio was EB by N naught, here EB by 2 N naught. So, there is approximately a difference of 3 dB in the performance of PSK and FSK. That is, FSK is inferior to PSK by 3 dB. We can say this on the basis of this expression. Now, let us consider generation and detection of a binary FSK signal. So, the incoming binary data sequence is first applied to on off level encoder, at the output of which symbol is represented by constant amplitude, as I already told you, root EB. Now, we are taking amplitude as root EB, and the term root 1 by TB cos 2 pi FCT is included in the carrier. So, in a product modulator, when you multiply, the resulting signal is root 2 EB by TB. So, root EB has been considered here, the amplitude of root EB volts, and symbol 0 is represented by, as usual, 0 volt. An inverter is used to in the lower channel, so that when symbol 1 is at the input, the oscillator with frequency F1 in the upper channel is switched on, while the oscillator with frequency F2 in the lower channel is switched off, with the result that frequency F1 is transmitted. Conversely, when symbol 0 is at the input, the oscillator in the upper channel is switched off and the oscillator in the lower channel is switched on, with the result that frequency F2 is transmitted. So, you can see the two frequencies F1 and F2 are chosen to equal different integer multiple. Now, this what I am reading here is the two frequency F1 and F2 are chosen to equal different integer multiples of bit rate 1 by TB. The reason for this is again that orthogonality has to be maintained. S1T and S2T will be orthogonal if the difference between the two frequencies, that is mod of F1 minus F2, should be an integer multiple of the bit rate, that is 1 by TB. The frequency of modulated wave is shifted with a continuous phase in accordance with the input binary wave. Now, to detect the original binary sequence, given the noisy received signal XT, the receiver in the figure, as I will be showing the figure, is used. It consists of two correlators, again two correlators, because two functions are there, one is of F1, another is of F2. So, this corresponds to the use of two correlators, which are supplied with locally generated coherent carrier signals. So, you can take a look at the picture now. In figure A, there is a binary FSK transmitter, the input is a binary data sequence, on off level encoder is there. The signal is given in the upper channel, we are having root 2 cos of F 2 pi F1 t, and the lower channel we are having a frequency corresponding to 0, that is F2 t, inverter is there. So, when 1 is transmitted, the upper channel is active, when 0 is transmitted, the lower channel is active, and the combined signal is the binary FSK signal. In the receiver, you can see two correlators are there corresponding to phi 1 t and phi 2 t, because we require here two carriers. One is having frequency F1, another is having frequency F2. Though these two frequencies are related to the carrier frequency FC, right? So, because two frequencies are involved, we have two correlators, multiplier followed by an integrator. So, we have two received elements, one is X1, another is X2. These are the elements, or sometimes they are also known as observable elements. So, when you observe these two elements, based on these two elements, you have to take the decision. Here the rule which is being followed is that you take the difference between the two values, the value at the upper correlator and the value at the lower correlator. So, the difference is X1 minus X2, and that is compared with 0. If difference is greater than 0, then the decision goes in favor of 1. If the difference is less than 0, then the decision goes in favor of 0. And this is how it works. The correlator outputs are then subtracted, as I have told you, one from the other, and the resulting difference Y is compared with the threshold of 0 volt. If Y is greater than 0, the receiver decides in favor of 1. On the other hand, if Y is less than 0, it decides in favor of 0. If Y is exactly 0, the receiver makes random guess in favor of 1 or 0. Now, random guess is, say, you can say it is similar to toss of a coin, right? So, when you toss a coin to make decision, that is a random guess. Now let us come to a scheme which is little bit different from the basic schemes which we have been discussing, that is ASK, FSK and PSK. All these three schemes are binary. This scheme is not binary. We call it as QPSK, that is quadriphase shift keying. An important goal in design of digital communication system is the efficient utilization of channel bandwidth. Coherent QPSK is a bandwidth conservation modulation scheme because it uses half bandwidth as compared to coherent BPSK for the same performance. In QPSK, as with binary PSK, information carried by the transmitted signal is contained in the phase. In particular, the phase of the carrier takes on one of the four equally spaced values, such as pi by 4, 3 pi by 4, 5 pi by 4 and 7 pi by 4. So, what we are doing is, see these values, in this case it has been given the values pi by 4, 3 pi by 4 and so on. So, we are transmitting 4 signals, 4 signals corresponding to 4 symbols, right. Now, to 4 symbols we require 2 bits per symbol. So, instead of transmitting a bit, we are transmitting a dibit by using the same signal. So, that is why this is actually the bandwidth conservation scheme, because one pulse is giving the information of 2 bits instead of a single bit. So, it conserves the bandwidth. Mathematically, we can write it like this: a set of values, the transmitted signal may be defined like this, as you can see here, SIT root 2 E by TB. Now, this is a little bit different. E is actually the transmitted symbol energy per symbol, and symbol contains 2 bits. Similarly, capital T is the symbol interval, so 2 bits. So, in this case, actually capital T will be twice of TB. So, when you put the values of I 1, 2, 3, 4, you can see that the phase which are being transmitted is pi by 4, 3 pi by 4, 5 pi by 4 and 7 pi by 4. Now, this kind of the position of these 4 phases actually depends on the constellation, right. You can also transmit 0, pi by 2, pi and so on. So, the rotation sometimes is not important here, but corresponding to 4 symbols, 4 phases are being transmitted. So, E corresponds to 1, 2, 3, 4. E is the transmitted signal energy per symbol and T is the symbol duration. The carrier frequency FC again equals NC by T for the same reasons, where NC is an integer. Each possible value of the phase corresponds to a unique dibit, 2 bits. For example, the above set of phase values may be chosen to represent the gray encoded set of dibits 10, 00, 01 and 11, where only a single bit is changed from one dibit to next. See, when you place a dibit, suppose if we consider a rectangular coordinate system, then 4 coordinates are there, 1, 2, 3 and 4, right. You are placing a symbol here 0, 0, then 0, 1, then 1, 0 and 1, 1 like this, say in a counterclockwise direction, right. Now, when you are going from one quadrant to another quadrant, then the bit should change in one single position only, that is 0, 0 can become 0, 1, but when 0, 1 becomes 1, 0, then both the bits are changing the position, and that is to be avoided. That is why we are using a gray encoded set of dibits, right. So, 0, 0, 0, 1, then 1, 1 and then 1, 0 like this. That is why we are using this gray encoded dibit. Actually, it improves the error performance of a system. Now, when we take a look at the average probability of symbol error, mind this is a symbol error, not bit error. The coherent QPSK is approximately PE is half ERFC root E by 2 and naught, where E is the symbol energy. Now, in a QPSK system, since there are 2 bits per symbol, the transmitted signal energy per symbol is twice the signal energy per bit as shown, as I have already told you, E is equal to 2 EB. Thus, expressing the average probability of symbol error in terms of the ratio of EB by A naught, as you can see, it comes out to be PE is complementary error function of root EB by A naught. Actually, it is approximated by this, but if you are using gray encoding, then the bit error rate of QPSK, it is exactly equal to BER is equal to half ERFC root EB by N naught. So, we can easily see that a coherent QPSK system achieves the same average probability of bit error as coherent PSK system for the same bit rate and same EB by N naught. Performance is same, but uses only a half channel bandwidth. This is a very big advantage when there is scarcity of the bandwidth. Stated in different way, for same EB by N naught and therefore the same average probability of bit error, a coherent QPSK system transmits information as twice the bit rate of coherent PSK system for the same channel bandwidth. So, bandwidth can be utilized in a better way if you use QPSK instead of BPSK. For a prescribed performance, QPSK uses channel bandwidth better than binary PSK, which explains the preferred use of QPSK over binary PSK in practice. Now, figure 4 shows the variation of the average probability of bit error PE with bit energy to density ratio EB by N naught. Now, this is the figure. If you take a look at this figure, it gives you the PE versus EB by N naught plot for various schemes, and you can see the best scheme from the figure, it is obvious, the lowest one is the binary BPSK. So, how to compare these schemes by looking at this figure? See, if you draw a horizontal line means you are making the performance fixed, that is, you are fixing the average probability of symbol error. If you are drawing a horizontal line, then average probability of symbol error is fixed. Now, the best scheme is which gives this average probability at the least SNR, that is, we have to transmit least power to gain the same performance, that one is the best scheme. So, if PE is fixed, then the best scheme is which uses least SNR to achieve that PE. On the other hand, if you draw a vertical line, then you fix the transmitted power, that is, SNR is fixed. So, the best scheme is that for a given transmitted power, which scheme attains the minimum error probability, and that again you can easily see from this binary PSK. Of course, coherent schemes are there. We have discussed only the coherent scheme. There is a non-coherent version of say ASK and FSK. Of course, non-coherent version of PSK is not possible because the information lies inside the phase, but other form is there. For example, DPSK, differential phase shift keying, is there, which you can say it is a non-coherent form of PSK. Otherwise, we have non-coherent ASK, non-coherent FSK, though the performance of non-coherent scheme is much inferior as compared to coherent scheme. But there in non-coherent, for receiving a non-coherent signal, you do not require a carrier at the receiving end, whereas in coherent system, the perfectly coherent carrier is required at the receiving end. So, in this lecture, we have discussed the digital passband transmission techniques. They are also known as digital modulation techniques, and we have explained the difference between the baseband and passband transmission. We have considered the block diagrams of the transmitter and receivers of the various digital modulation techniques and studied the effect of noise on their performance. I hope you all might have enjoyed the lecture. Thank you.